But tonight is Ephesians. I've taken some time, but let's prepare our heart and let's sing a song as we prepare ourselves for the Word of God. Amen. And the song that we will sing is okay. Your eye is on the sparrow. Oh, okay. I was wondering why it doesn't rotate. It's been stopped. Okay. I need to rotate back. Where's my rotation? Ah. Okay. Your eye is on the sparrow, your hand, it comforts me. Yeah, that's the only song I could think when I was there. And let's all rise together.
Your eye is on the sparrow, your hand, it comforts me.
Understanding to know that life on this earth is but a fleeting movement. But for us to do your perfect will is all that matters in this life. We seek not glory, we seek not fame, we seek not treasures, we seek not money. We only seek to do your perfect will. That's all that we live for. Thank you, Father, for all your grace, all your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God, give Jesus a good clap offering. You may be seated. And let's look at the translation, Ephesians 3 today. And over this weekend, I've been working out also translating the Bible. So I'll try to send you some of the other chapters over the coming weekend. So let's look at the translations. Let's on Ephesians chapter 3 today. We will look at verse 1 to 13 today. And where's my Ephesians here? And we should have the other copy too if you want. And let me get back to this. We are on chapter 3. So let's read the translation. Ephesians chapter 3. Is mine okay? Yours is better, right? Okay. So, chapter 3, verse 1, it says, "For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the administration of the grace of God, which had been given to me unto you, how that by revelation he made known to me the mystery as I've written before briefly, which by reading you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other generations was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets in the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be joint heirs and of the same body and joint partakers of his promise in Christ through the gospel, of which I became a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given to me by the working of his power. To me who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who had been creating all things through Jesus Christ, that now through the church the various manifold wisdom of God had been made known to the principalities and authorities in heavenly places, according to the design plan of the ages, which he had made in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access in complete confidence through his faith. Therefore I desire that you do not grow weary in my tribulations for you, which is your glory." Okay, that sounds very different from the normal thing that you read. Let's look at the normal translation for a moment. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 1 to 13. This is how it looks like. Oh, I got to turn the other way around. Okay, let's... says, "For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for you Gentiles, if indeed you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which was given to me for you." So, the "given to me for you" was not as strong as the other translation. The other translation brings it up. That it's really given to Paul, had been given to Paul, and to be passed on to them. And how that by revelation he made known to me the mystery as I have briefly written already, by which when you read you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages. Now here is actually different. We translate it as "which in other generations." The word "age" is should not be translated as "age." Is the word "genia," "genia" or "genia," is from the word "generation," and it refer to humans. When he say ages, it can refer to the age of the angels and previous ages or whatever things that existed before mankind came and whatever couldn't exist after this world has been annihilated and then a new earth, new heaven comes about. There's another different age. But genia, Greek is actually genia, means a generation or a time period of humans. And so we translate that in other generations, which refer to the human race, that it was not made known to other generations of human not in the Old Testament, not before, not even to Adam yet. He was not ready. And after the fall, not to anyone at all, including even Enoch who walked with God. Because the word generation will imply all other humans. Not even to anyone of Abraham or Moses or Elisha, all those things until the end time, which began in the church age. Remember, the last days begin with the outpouring of the Spirit. So there were certain things that God brought about, revealed by the Spirit to His holy apostles and prophets, that Gentiles should be and involve the revelation about who the Gentiles will become. The whole revelation is that God will bring back all the human race together, which is the Gentiles, to be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of His promise in Christ through the gospel, which I became a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given to me by the effective working of His power. To me, who am less than the least of all the saints, this grace was given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. That is a special word that we will study after in that translation, because the word unsearchable is only used in the New Testament, never in any Greek philosophy or writing before that. It was, you can say, Paul invented a word, or he used an obscure word and used it for the church. And to make all see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in heavenly places, according to the eternal purpose. Instead of design plan, they put eternal purpose. That word is a special word that is almost impossible to translate. Eternal purpose doesn't cover that, which He accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence and faith in Him. Therefore, I say, do not lose heart at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. So, some translation quite similar, just a slight added flavor, as you can see. Let's look back at the other translation. And here we have it. And starting again. Okay, having difficulty. Oh, I went out too fast. Okay, chapter 3 here. And so we should have yours, chapter 3 there. Thank you very much. Yes. Verse 1 to 3 emphasizes, remember what I call the stewardship or administration. The stewardship or administration of the grace of God. And this time he's very specific. Remember how in chapter 1 and 2 we introduced the concept of stewardship of the end time? And that the end time has a period of stewardship, which means there are many stewards. All of us are just stewards of the revelation or portions of the end time. It seems that God designed the end time with a group of people in mind. That's what the word administration implies. Among those people whom God designed was Paul. Because he said, had been given to me. Not only to Paul, of course, but Paul was one of those custodians of the end time. Had been given to me unto you. So here's the picture that we draw of the end times. And wait till the picture comes out. Okay, let's see where we are. We have the piece. I remember there's one section that I got to complete tomorrow night. Okay. So let's say these are the end time period. I circle, let's say this. And the other ages of man are all the other ages, but the end time is special. So there is a special dispensation of the end times. In this special dispensation, that means there are chosen individuals. That will be too small. Okay, let me draw them little circles. There are stewards And of course, each linked to another, each one got their own responsibilities. And the end time is like chock-a-block of territory, authority, or stewardship. And each person is assigned to their dispensation. From the end time began when the church age started in Acts 2. And it ends in a rapture. Rapture. Because remember, Peter stood up and said, in the last days, God will pour out His Spirit. So that's the end time beginning. We are the midnight hour of the end time. The day started from them. In the last days, I will consider these are just days to God. 2,000 years have passed by, 2 days. Almost like 2 days to the Lord. And in the last days, the days are 1,000 years, we are past the midnight hour, and we are in the last section, that when it is time to harvest, God says, count 7 times 7 weeks. We are in the last 49 years. The last 7th cycle, when the harvest begins. So this dispensation has been given to individuals. You think God would plan it at the last minute? No. Paul revealed to us that way before time began, all this stewardship was planned from there. That's why he started in Ephesians 1 with, in Him, you're blessed with all spiritual blessings. You notice the tie up is the heavenly places that tie everything together. That God planned His biggest and greatest revelation to be His bride. His church. This is a finale of all finale that God has planned. Everything was leading towards that. It is a privilege to live in these end times when Jesus has come. And everyone who lives in this time period has been predestined. Your training began in heaven, right here. You came to the earth for a purpose. It was very strange because in the early days, I remember after I went to heaven for about 6 weeks or 8 weeks over, why do I didn't give a specific time, like 8 weeks or 6 weeks, why give 6 to 8 weeks? Because it sort of taper off towards that time period, and it used to be every day, and then it taper off. In that time period, in 2006, then after that, I make a trip to New Zealand, and then a question was asked to me by a Bible student who was there. And I met some people. I met one of those little kids who were healed of deafness, and by that time they've grown up and they were still healed, praise the Lord. And that was in New Zealand. And then during one of the sessions, one of the Bible students from where was the place, Tauranga, asked me this question. Say, Pastor, there is a question that I've asked every person and they've never been able to answer. I say, ask away. And he says, I have this image and vision all my life that before I was born, I saw this image, like in this place, I was like in a certain place, like in space as looking at the earth. And then I was told about what I was to do. And then there was something he described that after certain things were advised or told or instructions, I went into this like a shoot kind of thing. And then sort of something happened, like he disappeared or went into it. And then he was born. He says, what is that? He said, what is that? Is there such a place? And I said, there is such a place. In that place, all of us are shown what we will become, what we will do, the things that you will face, the difficulties you choose on your road in life before you came. I saw that in heaven. Now, some of you might find it very hard to believe, and you might say, give me a scripture for that. The closest I can give you is that that place is located quite close to the arena of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. You say, what is Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1? There is an arena saying that we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. And it looks like this cloud of witnesses are looking at a race. And we are the one running the race. Jesus having run that race. And we have to run the race. So what is this arena that people are looking at us? So Hebrews chapter 12 verse 1, in this arena where people are looking now at us, the people who are looking at us are the people that are mentioned in Hebrews 11. Where he named all the Old Testament people who walk with God, and then say, having been surrounded by these people, he called them cloud of witnesses. They're witnessing what's happening on the earth. So I would say that there is an actual place where you can look at what's going on the earth. For the Lord, he doesn't have to move because the sea of glass can show anything. But among those in the heavens, in the third heaven, there is a place you could go to look at what's happening on the earth. And down here, it's a race that we are on. Running the race to grow in God, to know God. So I said, that place is pretty much the same section of heaven which you can look down to the earth, and where people are also sent down. Everyone to be born again. Even right now, we are contemporaries with some of the 144,000 already been born. So there is a place where you can look at the earth before you come down. And all of us who are stewards, Paul was one of the stewards. Every single one of you born into this last of the end days. If you're alive right now, during this period of 7 times 7 years, you have a destiny. Otherwise, you'll be dead. If you're alive right now, in this 7 times 7 years which has begun, when the glory came upon Pergamos in 2012, you have a destiny. You were not born by accident. You were specially chosen and trained to come upon this time to do a work. We already know some people who have a destiny and had turned them down. God had all the plan A and plan B in line. See, who are those? They are those who have been part of this end time, who have rejected their calling. Which means that they are no more in the race. But everyone has been given a stewardship. A stewardship means you are given certain things to handle. You can either choose to accept or choose not to accept. not a single bit of destiny. You see these crisscross lines? If a person in this section neglects his section, it is possible that a person in this section might have this added to the person. Say, how can a person contain so much thing? Because this person might have other people under them. Remember the parable of the 10 talent versus the 1 talent? Where did the 1 talent go to?
The one with 10 talent.
Correct. And remember, somebody made a comment in the parable. Lord, he already got 10. That's why he can handle one more with no problem. If you give to another person who have only 2, the person had to take on 50%, because he can, additional 1 is 50%. For the person who has already 10, one more is only 10%. No problem, just continue. Because the person can handle. And remember, those in the highest are not because they are like Hercules and everyone is like tiny ant. It is because they are leaders of 50s, 100s, 1000s, 10,000s of millions. It's actually not them, it's those who function under them. In the Bible, remember, this end time is tied to David. We haven't teach a series called David and the End Times. And the things about that are in David that are directly synchronized to the end time. Let me just give you one of those points. In David's time, he organized the army into people who can, there are some who can control the whole army. There are some who are personal guards. There are some who can only be over 10,000. Some are 5,000. And then there are captains over 100 and captains over 50, correct? A centurion is over 100 soldiers in the Roman Empire. So there are different captains. Everyone has to organize. In the end, it all comes down to small groups. But not all captains of 50s can handle 100. But the one who is 1,000 can handle anything below. He can come down and handle 50 easily. See, the 10 talents can handle, if the 10 talent got only 1 talent, of course he can handle it. But the Lord gave more because he might handle it 10% and then he's free. Because it does everything so effectively, he got so much free time. Because he got organized today. Everyone got the same time, 24 hours. It's what we achieve in our life that's important. How much can you produce in one life? That's important. And that takes training to produce more out of one life. And I say, you know, I'm living many lives. Some people live their entire life just translating the Bible and then they die, kaput. Right? For me, translating the Bible is a sideline. There's added. So by the time I finish, I would have a whole Bible called the Logos King James already. And that will also be archived in heaven. Because I saw it already finished. Oh, they're finished here, still working. Thank you, Lord. So it's important for us to know that these are things that God has assigned. But I repeat, just because you got a bigger portion doesn't mean you're a Lone Ranger. Don't be proud. Don't say, oh, I captain 1,000, you 50. Yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. As soon as you reduce the captain of 1. But the truth is this, that Paul brings to us this fact. And this is where Paul understood that. Can you see the word there? That, we bring yours, this is a better one. It says, which has been given to me unto you. That means those that are under Paul function under him. And this is a thing that we must learn. That when you are serving under a captain, let's say, of 1,000, and you're called, let's say a captain of 1,000, all those that are under the captain of the thousand will be dysfunctional without the captain of the thousand. Okay, the mighty man without David are nothing. Just as David without the mighty man also won't have a powerful army. He's also nothing, correct? The union is that you depend on each other. Except that you accept that that person is your chosen leader. Some destinies are that way. You function under that person. Like some of you might have visions of the Apostle Paul when he went to Ephesus and all that. You will understand that all those who are under Paul, like Epaphroditus, Titus, Timothy, although they could do a work of the ministry, in heaven they also function together with Paul. It's like a choir. A work of God is like a choir. A choir. Will the violinist protest that I want to be a solo? I want to play solo. I want to play solo. Cannot. If you're part of a concert, you're part of a concert. If you're part of the 144,000, you're part of the 144,000. In heaven, you cannot say, I want to be one and I leave the 144,000, make that 143,000. No, the number should be 143,999. Because one came out. Cannot! Do you know that we function as an organism? Oh, I haven't revealed some things yet. In heaven, the power of uniting together. Remember, all of us become one, we look like Jesus. And sections of the body, when they function, they have the capacity to join and become one being. That's how powerful it is. In the heavenly dimension. So the training is on the earth to learn to function that way. And it's not just the three musketeers. All for one and one for all. Okay, fine. You want the three musketeers theory. The all for one, one for all is not. Okay, let me ask you the question. How many musketeers are there in the movie one?
Three,
four. But how come they're always three? Okay, the story is always right. In all the stories, the three musketeers, correct? But there's always four. Because the three were the prominent ones, like Smart Alex said. But the fourth was an important addition to their three. And they function as one. In the function of God, it is thousands, sometimes groups of 50s, and sometimes they are like similar duplicate. How many physical eyes do you have? Hey, easy question. Dua, two, eat, okay. I was gonna look at Indian language, and my language in English not so good. Okay. What? Laha Lukong, two in Kachin. What's in Rendon. Lebanese.
Nine.
Why? Two eyes, two ears, but only one nose and one mouth. In the design of the administration of the ages, some things are in pairs, some things are single. It would be very horrible if you got two nose. One in front, one in the back. Not too bad, you know, close one side, the other side still breathe, but, you know, I don't think that's the way God wants to design it. So, or if you only got one big eye. Now, each one of our tissues or organs are made of millions of cells. Millions of cells. We have trillions of cells firing together. The cells are grouped to function together. And they function as a group, as one. In the administration of the ages, Paul says, is be given to me unto you. The mighty man without David would be nothing. And you know what the mighty man must always do? Be with David. Sing or swim. Live or die. You know why? If they left him, they will really die. Before that, they were dying, what? The three D's? Dead, distressed, and discontented. They were dead anyway. So, there is this kind of bonding that God is teaching us. And it is as hard to be number two and number three as it is to be number one. Because forever, you will not be noticed. Some people who are there might notice, but not all. But yet, we are not here to get noticed. The only person you want who notices you is the Lord Jesus Christ. As long as He knows. As long as He rewards you. What we want is the attention of Jesus, not the attention of man. Of course, it's all in our DNA. So, in our DNA, if we learn to be invisible, we learn to be invisible. And you learn to work behind the scene. Each has its challenges. Because when God makes you a public figure, you're also a public figure of ridicule. A public figure who gets all the jokes and flags and everything. The good and the bad goes with it. Are you able to live your life like that? Not everybody can live their life like that. So every situation in life has its challenges. The administration of the ages and end times is given to one to lead a group. That's what it's meaning. Sometimes it's a small section, sometimes it's a bigger section. What does that mean to us? It means sometimes you find a destiny through another person. You don't just find your destiny. Because our destinies could be linked to another person. At the moment you decide that you could be one of the five fingers. If you decided that you don't want, it becomes four finger. And you thought it would be four finger. No. God will add that to somebody else who will function as a finger. Because God has anticipated all things. Remember the revelation I said that when God created anything, the rubber band is pulling back. That it will always end with five fingers. No matter how it pulls. That is the way God has designed things. And it cannot go but perfection at the ending. And it is important for us to know this truth. And let me look at any others. Okay, Jonathan and David. Jonathan was like David's best pal. Not a marriage soulmate, but a friend soulmate. A teammate. And even Jonathan said, when the day come, you will be king, I will be next to you. Remember that in a natural, Jonathan is the one to be king. Because his father is Saul. But that means that he was prepared, if his father died, to abdicate and let David be king because the word of God prophesied David should be king. David is a very good man. He is the crown prince. Imagine the crown prince saying to the chosen of God, when the day come, you be king, I will be next to you. I will support you all the way, David. Because he knows he's not the chosen one to lead. And let me tell you, he would not have the skills that David had. Now to learn some of the skills, remember in the early part of sharing I talked about the catching mini vision? You think the skills just come easily? You know how hard David had to work to earn the kingdom? To gain the skills of the kingdom? He didn't have it the easy way. He became famous. Yes, to killing one Goliath. But look at how he became a vagabond, chased, running, learning to shelter. These are all army training God forced him to go through. While Saul was pursuing him. And even when he became king, he had to fight a civil war for 7 years before the other 10 tribes accept him as king. But the day all the tribes accept him as king, they were in the right position. Then only Israel became great. Because these are all by predestination. When the order time comes, it comes. And I can guarantee you, in this revival, that all denominations will die. And everything will come under our Lord Jesus Christ and the structure of His administration. Every other human structure will be broken down. Because God will not permit denominationalism in heaven. He has to die somewhere on this planet. As we go towards the future, denominationalism will die. And in the end, there only rise one glorious church, united, united under the right leadership. They can choose Ish-bosheth, can choose Abner, but until they choose and flow under the right leadership, there will always be disharmony. We don't choose who we can be. These are things determined from heaven. Remember, the disciples thought they can decide. After all, they thought Jesus was going to be king and mighty. They were fighting to be the right and the left hand. And Jesus, even James and John even recruit the mother. They recruit the mother. Because Jesus respect all the elderly women, I'm sure. And then Jesus, in the end, Jesus answer. Not my decision. Decided by Heavenly Father. So, that is what it means by administration. There are many stewards. The 500 are the chosen stewards of God. In this 7 times 7 years. I call myself the coordinator. And I just see as a job function. And then I begin to understand more about what being the right hand of God means. Is it being the right hand of God, why God revealed in this end time is this? Is to teach people all the rights and privileges of being the right hand. That's it. And one had to experience it to teach it, because here's the thing, we are all seated at the right hand. Correct? Ephesians 2. So how does God teach us how to be at the right hand? He has to choose a few individuals, experience it, and then teach the rest. He has to start with one or two. So that's interesting. And before all these things happened, before this revival began, in one of my early days in Malaysia in Tabernacle Glory, and we used to produce this newsletter. If you all remember long, long ago, those you followed, remember there was one time I shared about when I was in Sabah, in a Sabah convention, that the Lord took me in a vision and put me to sit down at His right hand to experience all that is in the right hand. If you all remember that. It's recorded somewhere. And then I could sense the awesomeness of power that was flowing. All these are really predicting towards things happening in the future. In the end, as you know, in Joseph's life, all things tie together. All things come to a conclusion. So we have here Paul saying that it was given to him to be distributed to the others. No leader is a leader by themselves. Even today, the richest man alive cannot live his life of riches without all the servants and help. If all their servants run away, let's say he cannot employ anyone with all his money and gold and silver, his big 1,000 room house will go into ruins. Why? Who's going to sweep the floor? How many rooms can you sweep? Let's say there are no servants. You see, all the rich today exist because they got a lot of people serving them. Everything is based on the community. And it's important to identify that an organism is made up of many. But when many, you need to decide. Like people say, oh, right now we're all equal, we're all priests and John priest. Like, you get 12 people together, you don't have a chairman, you're in trouble. In the end, you have to say, elect a chairman. Because if everybody, if you let it loose and get have what I call it, anarchy, you know what will happen in anarchy? Mafia will come up. The bullies will rise. You won't have to write out a leader. It will be the one who can bully the most, the one who can shout the most, the one who can talk the most. But the one who can talk the most might not be the smartest. The one who can bully everybody might be the most stupid guy without any strategy. You lead everybody to death. Correct. In the end, the guy that you want is a guy who can listen to every idea, give everyone a chance, evaluate everything, and then find the best solution and persuade everyone to show everyone that that is the best solution, and then unite everyone, then they go together. And sometimes it's a different style of leadership. There are two contrasting style of leadership. One is military, the other is democracy. Both styles are needed. You know why? Armies are good at fighting wars. If you don't have a good army, you can never win war. Army is top down, no questions. The only thing you say is, yes, sir. But and when an army has conquered a land or country or built an empire, that army is not the best government. Armies are made for wars, to win wars. Armies do not make good government. Because every government they create will be army style. Army style equals dictatorship. That's all they're good for. Because that's their background. Dictator, I dictate, you obey. Once in a blue moon, you got a nice benevolent dictator. So everybody enjoy. But that doesn't excuse that system is not the best. The best government is one from the bottom up. Which is opposite from the army. The one where everybody's needs are heard. Everybody's requests are somehow heard. Everybody got to say and understand that if I sacrifice, it's for the good of all. And they're willing to sacrifice. Because when you got 1,000 people, 1,000 people cannot have their way. You need a leader to say, okay, it happened that 80% like this, 20% like this. So we got to create a system in which the 80% still rule, but we give the 20% some allowances. That takes skill. It's from the bottom up that you build a government. Whereas, that one fighting war horrible. Because by the time they say, hey, should we do this, should we do that? This opinion, that whatever. By the time they half finish the argument, they all got shot and dead. Not good for fighting war. Good for governing people, making sure everyone had their needs met. You come to war, you need the military stuff. And the funny thing is, the Bible had to function in both. Paul sometimes illustrates like an army. And sometimes he illustrates how everyone is an heir and joint heir. Can you see the contrasting thing? But we need to understand. Like in this Exodus time, when you got 6 billion people, to move forward, you can move like an army. To govern them, you need a lot of strata to hear the people. Moses did not build a dictatorship. Moses in the end was told to have these 70 elders, and then the people can go to them for their needs, because there are little tiny things that needs. And Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, came and said, you one person want to govern these 3 million people? You know, you won't have time for all their little disputes. And so he has a system of government that, you know, that take care of all the other things. That is administration. The grace of God and this end time has been given. And why I touch on this point? Because you might be one of those chosen to a special group, special task. And what am I saying? You will never be alone. Don't think that you're the only special one. Then if that is so, you're probably the ingrown toe, ingrown toenail. Need to cut off. Everyone will have a group of people that they link with to be unique, to rise in a section of the body of Christ that you build. We need to understand that. And so that everyone benefits, you can see, which in other generations in verse 5 was not made known to the sons of men, as he has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets. You notice the top rung, the whole completion is always by apostles and prophets. God still have his order, and this is New Testament. This is New Testament, because apostles don't exist in the Old Testament. And there may be fivefold ministries. Individual pastors or teachers or evangelists cannot see the whole picture. It's only as the apostles and prophets have been given that overall thing that God shows them. Verse 6. That the Gentiles should be joint heirs of the same body and of joint partakers of his promise in Christ through the gospel. What is the difference between joint heirs and joint partakers? Because he used two different Greek words. Joint partakers versus joint heirs. Thinking. Okay. Joint heirs means if I have, let's say, okay, now that I use this, okay, we don't need this. Oh, I might need this in case I need to repeat some things. Let me see anything I could destroy. Okay, let me not take that. Piece of paper, a loose old piece of paper. Okay, that's good. Yeah. Okay, I can destroy this. Thank you. Okay. So, let's say this represents an inheritance. Let's say, actually, it could be gold, silver, whatever. So, when inheritance is there, it is broken up. Let's say this is 2. I didn't take 100% 50, but that's it. Then, if there's 2% sharing, if there are 4 people sharing, I got to make it in a quarter. Correct? So 4 pieces. If there are 8 people, I have to tear even more, and it becomes 8 pieces. So joint means all sharing together. Correct? Or one giant piece. Of course, that piece is huge because that piece is Christ and God. So even though you got the tiny little bit, joint means equal sharing. It doesn't mean that one person had a bigger piece than the other. I know what some people are thinking. They think I got a bigger piece of Jesus than other people. Any bitter lion means I got a lion share, you know, bigger than everybody. No, joint heirs. We are joint heirs. We are not unequal heirs. We are joint heirs. But why is it all in the same sentence? And this is the meaning. That is, remember I said that David cannot exist without the mighty man, the mighty man cannot exist without him. But with the mighty man, he built a kingdom. Okay, David alone can fight. But you saw what the mighty men did, right, in the Old Testament. There are records about them. Some of them slay lions in the snow. Some of them fight, you know, and kill 100 people with one spear. Those are things that David himself did not do. They are famous in fighting and battle. Each got their own skill. But each would have been a mercenary. But together, they form an army and a nation. And David was leader over them. David looks like he got the lion's share, correct? But he didn't actually get the lion's share. His lion's share exists together with the mighty man. Can you see that? Let's say,
Pastor,
yes.
Actually, lion's share include all the suffering.
Yes, of course too. To be the leader include the lion's share of the suffering. So that one, everybody already run away, right? But I want to show you in detail how it exists. Okay, let's say if I'm called to lead, let's say, 6 billion people. Okay, is it really possible for one person to lead 6 billion? No. That means that calling has to include a whole group of mighty men. Correct? The mighty men share in the glory. The mighty men share in the battle. The mighty men might be able to do some things that I cannot do. Like you can slay 100 people with a spear, where I slay one Goliath. Different skills. But they learn that they are joint heirs together. So when you look at David, and if all the pieces are divided, David will have an equal share with them. But David's share look a lot, because David's share look like this. Because his share was shared with the rest. And he ended up everybody else was there. But when you look at it and individualize it, everybody actually has an equal share. Because we are all one human being. With your soulmate, of course. We are all only one human being. Yes.
Can you explain just to clarify, compared to the rewards that David would get versus the mighty man, is that the understanding separate?
Thank you. Good question. When it comes to the reward in heaven, let's say David receive it. Even in heaven, the reward is shared with all the others, because permanently you have become one organism. When God rewarded the 144,000, they all sang one song. They permanently function as one. That is their specialty. But wait. That one sentence is a very pregnant sentence. It says they are joint heirs, joint partakers. Do you know what joint partaking means? It means you cannot eat by yourself. You have to wait for everybody in that team together, to eat together, which is one of the things that David did. David make a law that all those who go out will share with those who left behind, partaking together. And then those who rise up in David's army rose based on their achievements, not based on their own claim. Remember, David says, whoever conquers Zion will be captain of my whole army. Joab did it. One of the mighty men, Joab. Because there are 30 mighty men. They all would want to do it. But Joab succeeded. He found a way to get them. That shows ingenuity, ideas. Because no one, they were so proud, the Jebusites, who controlled Jerusalem. They said no one can conquer it. The one who found a way became the captain of the whole army. Joab was the one. If only Joab didn't have personal grudges because his brother died in the civil war, he might have been quite a perfect guy. He allowed personal grudges against Abner, and later personal grudges against David and Solomon over Uriah to rob him of his future or his greatness. Then as we read on, Paul talks about joint partakers. Joint partakers means you can only receive it together. God will wait until that critical mass you have built. Then together, God pour something out. Phew. That is why it's a different thing if you run around the whole world building altars by yourself. The anointing is different. There will be some blessing. Versus when you go as a group, there is something added. Something added. Like this trip I have to make a personal trip. But somewhere in the near future, we'll make a bigger trip when we are ready. And then you can see the camps for yourself. Maybe we might do it, in the coming near future, at a time when we can do a lot more. And the impact will be even greater, and the blessing back will be even greater. So, partaking together means like some things you cannot receive except that the group is united to receive it together. Let's say the building of the Euro tunnel. It was visualized long ago. Right? They've been talking about digging a tunnel under the English Channel. And the original guys all died. In the end, they succeeded. But they could only do it as a group. Okay. You see the buildings, skyscrapers, all this coming up today. It takes the architect, the engineer, the skilled construction worker to build a building. We all know it's true today. We all like little ants. Each one must do their part to bring it together. Because the skills are so specified that without the proper skills, you cannot. Let's say sending a person to the moon by a rocket or sending a rocket to space. It's not just the famous, the astronauts might be the people who became famous. But it takes thousands of scientists operating everything together. Some people might be just taking care of the carbon dioxide oxygen level. You need one person observing everything. And thousands of things are being monitored to succeed in putting one man on the moon. Or group of men on the moon. It is a task that we humans have to do together. You cannot do alone. Even if you hijack a rocket, if that's possible, and found a way to turn on the ignition by yourself, you still won't succeed. Because you still need oxygen, monitoring, trajectory, coming back, And then how do you come back at the right angle? You die. It's a death trap. There are certain things that humans need to do as a group. We understand that in technology. Same way, we need to understand that the natural is a picture of the spiritual. There are certain things that a group in the spiritual can do more than one. And if you find what I call your group, the army who are closest linked to you, that you are to function as a group. If I can use these words, it's not exactly 144,000. But the 144,000 is the Bible, so it's a good illustration. Do you know that the 144,000 have to find each other? And they have to be united. And God already ordained a rabbi. The rabbi was turned 12, I think 2 years ago or so. So he'll be 14 by now. He's a small little boy. I turned 12 about 2 years ago. That rabbi, he was 12 in 2013. So 14, 15, 16, 17, 4 years, what time had passed, eh? So, okay. It was 2013, he was 12. 12 plus 4, wow. He's 16 plus now. That rabbi has been chosen from predestination. Enoch is going to appear to him. See, God doesn't leave the administration, the end time, to chance. People have been chosen, but like, you know, you got the lion's share or reward, you got the lion's share. He's going to be actually the one who bring the 144,000 together. But the moment the rapture comes, he's also the first one to die. He and his family all will be killed and martyred. Martyrdom is his road. But then the 144,000 will come together under Enoch and Elijah. And it's just like this. No one is alone. You have to find your own, quote unquote, 144,000. Although the number is not 144,000, it might be just 70, 100. Sometimes the number could be like, you know, 444,000 or whatever you want. Whatever grouping that is, but it has to start with one or two to begin. And you notice that sometimes, how do I know that I link to the right group? It's so simple. The moment you link, what will happen? More energy, more anointing, more flow. Then you know, hey, we got it. Where's it? Now you got two of the 144,000. Let's get one more. What, three? What, four? By the time they got 44, oh. By the time they reach 100, oh. By the time they reach 144,000, exactly, boom. Like a mushroom cloud, but a good one. A thermonuclear explosion of energy release. And that is why some people ask a question. Why is it that when people come, they got no gift, no gift, suddenly come, boom, the gift works? Because this is the atmosphere when you link correctly. When you link wrongly, it reduces, the energy reduces. Because it is an accumulation of energy. Think about the simple thing like right now, your eyes looking and watching. You know how many muscles are in your eyes? To even see? It's not just one muscle. What do you think? I got only one muscle. The one that stretched the, you know. No, there's a lot of muscle. Going to move, you know. And your eye actually goes. Then there's one part that goes. Then there's one part that goes. How many muscles? Anybody did a research on any muscles? More. Six only? A lot. Now this only muscles people are interested in is, you know, the biceps and the six-pack. You know, your bicep and six-pack will actually organize, you know, in order so that to keep the spinal cord in position, you know, when you twist and turn. But your eye muscles are even more valuable, important. Build six pack for your eyes. Wow. So it's important for you to understand that nothing in the body is done by itself. Okay, the simple act of walking. You know how many muscles are involved to coordinate that? People who have stroke, who cannot move and cannot move some of their muscles, thank God they can hold a spoon. Hallelujah. But we all learn that as a baby. And the simple act of taking a spoon and putting it in your mouth, you know how many muscles are involved? Your eye muscles?
Six.
I got six muscles, eh?
Six.
Okay, you just did your research. Thank you very much. So, then, okay, to take a spoon to your mouth, eye, hand, fingers, nerves, there's a lot of coordination, but it's so simple, we do it without thinking. Because they work nicely together. When they don't work nicely and one part fails, it's like a person having a stroke. Becomes very difficult. And just out of interest, since Alex, you're not doing any typing, can you come up here for a moment? Can I remove your glasses for temporarily? Just put it aside. Okay. Close your eyes very tight. Okay. Okay. Let's see. Okay. Now, loosen this hand. And without opening your eyes, using your forefinger. Can I see your forefinger? Yeah, this is a forefinger. Okay. Can you move it without your eyes seeing and touching the tip of your nose in one movement?
What? Sorry?
Touch the tip of your nose.
Oh, touch the tip of my nose.
Without opening your eyes.
Okay. Yeah.
Not bad, eh? We can do it. How does he know, eh? How your nose is? Okay. You just know it?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how about moving that and touching your left eyebrow in the center? Wow, still can. Okay, then you can open your eyes right now. Okay. Look at the camera. And this is a trick I always teach the children. Put your hands this way.
Yeah.
Through one another.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
No. Don't do it this way.
Okay.
This way. Join together.
Okay.
And then move it in.
Mm-hmm.
Move it out.
Yeah.
This way. Okay, hold it right there.
Okay.
Okay. When I point to the finger, you just lift the finger. This one. Quickly, this one.
Oh.
This one. This one.
Okay.
Wrong one. Okay. I got a confusion. I got a bit. Thank you very much. I got the trick there on you. Thank you. So, see, after this one, and you do this, and someone point, move the finger. Okay. See, the coordination went off. And so, it takes coordination of the body to do the simplest thing. Many muscles are involved, and there is that, and that's talking about joint partakers. That you learn to jointly, which is why the Bible says, do not neglect the fellowship with believers. You think that you can hear the sermons alone, all by yourself, in a little room, cubicle, you know, wow, you can hear all my sermons, hear all these things, and you will grow. There will still be something you miss. The fellowship of believers. And when you pray together as a group, it's different when you pray alone. There are some things you can only receive as a group if you're there. Now some people say, hey, I'm not there, can I just watch a video and catch the anointing? Catch the anointing. Every time it's catch the anointing. And your name is Lone Ranger. No, your actual name is, first name is Lone Ranger. You forgot your surname. So what's your surname? It's Minus Tonto. So your full name is Lone Ranger Minus Tonto. And so you're like, catch the anointing. Sorry. God knows all things. God will always have a group that you must be together. And if you are innocently and really cannot be there, of course God will let you catch anointing. But you purposefully, when God told you to be there, you purposefully choose not to be there. All you catch is air. Nothing else. Because God said you refuse to go there when I told you. You're supposed to catch it there. Okay, some of you think, Pastor, you're making it up. Why do you think God sent Elijah all the way 40 days to Mount Horeb just to tell him something he could have told him 40 days ago? Right, remember? Whatever he told him, then he could have told him there, under the, what I call, the sycamore tree. Same message. The only message is, you know, why are you here? After traveling 40 days and 40 nights, Elijah, why are you here? You told me to be here. Because sometimes God makes you travel distances as an act of faith. God makes you to be part of a fellowship or group as an act of your faith. God makes you part of a group to learn to love, to learn to care. And I agree with everyone else. It's easier to live your life alone, to have all the hassle and all the idiosyncrasies of the people around you. Of course, you're dignified, controlled life. But your name again is Lone Ranger, surname minus Tonto. So fill that up in your immigration form. First name, Lone Ranger. Surname, minus Tonto. Because that's who you are. That's not the way God anoint us. He wants us to be partakers. Something cannot be partaken. And forever, it is recorded in heaven, 120 receive the Holy Spirit. The rest, they got some things in the end. But in heaven's archive, the 120 got a special blessing that the others did not have. Even what you partake and partake through various formats, there's still something that is different. Still something that is different. In the age of the internet and modern communication, people thought that internet ministry is equal to live ministry. It's never. If it's so, Jesus would have waited until the internet age and then come. And then he don't even have to move. He could just shift his entire throne. Then he don't have to move. I am Jesus. And the whole world hears him. Now, he has to live a life. So we have here Paul, of course, recognizing this in verse 8. He says, I am less than the least of all saints. Do you notice how great he was to have the administration? But then it comes to this point when he says that I am less than the least of all saints. How? Because the higher you are, the more sufferings and the more emptying you need. The greatest among you must be the servant of all. And sometimes people wonder, the path that God took Paul. Paul became actually, if you look at history today, Christian history, we all acknowledge Paul was the one. It is the one who, in the foundation of the church, he is the one. Most of the New Testament is written by him. Take away Paul's revelation, we will lose almost 90% of our doctrine today. Because what kind of doctrine can you form with the Gospels. Some. But some of the outstanding things he taught through and he wrote about, Romans, Galatians, Ephesians, Colossians, Corinthians, you wouldn't even know such a thing as the nine gifts of the Spirit. Where in the four Gospels he talked about nine gifts of the Spirit? There are tons of knowledge that came from him. He's the one. But to be the one, he has to also be the nobody. And God really took him through that path until he has an awareness that he is nothing. So while you develop your authority in God until so high, God also wants you to develop a sense of knowing your nothingness. And it looks like the table is this way. Okay, we're done. The table is this way. This is the height of greatness. Give me the pen. And this is the height of. And this is 0.0. This is plus 1, plus 2, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, plus 3, etc. It looks like a musical energy. Do you know all energy that flow is in waves? And it looks like a sine wave. Let's say it flows up there. Its power to flow up there is because it flows down here. And then it goes okay. The depth of this equals the height of this. The ability of it to be here is the same ability that goes there. Okay. Let's say you are to jump. If I don't jump without bending your knees, how far can you jump without bending your knees? Well, that's tough, man. But if you could bend your knees, you could spring. And the more you position yourself to spring, the more you can jump. It looks like every ability to rise up was made from the ability to come down. Like a sine wave. The two are equal. So if you refuse to come down all the way, you only come down to here, then the wave of energy in your life will only be, since you're willing to come down this way, then the energy that you have will only be here. Whereas you see somebody else functioning in this wave, you're functioning in this wave. Who's to blame? Yourself. That's why Paul says, he know within himself that he is the least. But actually, he was the greatest apostle that lived in the first 100 years. Besides, John was the other one who came up. But John, not much writing. He was a doer more than a writer. It took a Paul to come up with all these doctrines. He was the greatest theologian God gifted to us to understand the things of God. And it looks like I won't have time to do more than that, but I just want to point to these little things so you know what's coming next week. I wanted to go to verse 13, but I could not. So we end with verse 8, but I just want to point to this. Verse 11, you know the word design plan? That I have here. The word design plan, if you look at the footnotes under 95, the word design plan is the same Greek word for showbread. That's why I say it was impossible to translate. I show you in the normal version, we have the that verse inside. To the intent and now eternal purpose. Hey, this one, eternal purpose. Prothesis. Okay. Can you see that they also recognize it's the word for showbread? Now, prothesis has been translated as showbread in Matthew. In Matthew, it's been translated as showbread. Okay. And I'll just highlight it, Matthew, so you can see there. Showbread. And in Mark 2:26, showbread. In Luke 6:4, showbread. And only when it goes to Paul's writings, and does it take on the word purpose in 11:23 with purpose of heart. And so there is a development of this word or prothesis. Why in the writings of the apostles it is showbread, showbread, and then even in Hebrews 9:2, it's also still showbread. So what is he talking about? In the end, it is saying, we are the showbread of God. Apparently, the showbread was a special display. It must always be 12 loaves. When a priest eat it, they would take what is there and put a fresh one. It is also a pattern that is there. So God was showing that, that's why he called the showbread. The bread that is shown, only the priest can see it. That is why the clearest translation I brought across was, there's a design and a pattern. So when they say, I have purpose in my heart, that means I have an exact design and plan. And that one can apply to all the translations. And we end with that verse and go to it the next week. When Paul says in verse, looking in verse 11, that he has chosen the church to be the design plan to show to all the principalities and powers and authorities in any places. The church will manifest the design plan of the mystery of God to the angels, to the spirit beings and all. You know, as an evangelical, still giving due respect to all the angels that are here, in many Christian testimonies and in many of the testimonies people have, which is good, when they have one angel, they say, wow, wow, angel, wow, wow. They have not seen what they are. In the New Testament, the angels are the one looking at you and say, wow, wow, wow. And so, to the untrained, unlearned Christian, we're looking at the angels. And to the junior angels who haven't learned yet, they look at the human race. You put them together, both say. And the top angels and the top saints will say, what are these young folks doing? What Paul was trying to say, Paul knew who he was. Isn't he the guy who said we were judge angels? Isn't he the guy who said in the book of Hebrews, that's in Corinthians, he the guy who said in Hebrews, had God ever sent aid to the angels? Paul had a glimpse of the bright. The angels are beautiful, glorious. They have their role. We need them. And we always work with them and be with them. But he saw You know, we don't take it with pride, in a good sense. We don't take it in a, with honor. Maybe pride is the wrong word to use. Like, we are Mrs. Jesus. Right, Mrs. Alex? You were disturbing your husband just now. Right. Do you know none of the angel can be Mrs. Jesus? It's almost like Mrs. God. As if there's a counterpart to God. You and I are. It's something that the angels say. You know, in the end, well, our young ones on this side, one angel already say, wow, I got an angel following me. I got an angel following me. The angel will say, wow, I got a saint following. I'm following the saint. You know? But between the wow, where the young Christians say, wow, and the young untrained angel or learning angel, new recruit to the planet Earth, whatever it was, say, wow, you know, their wah is bigger than their human wah. Because the position of being in Christ is the closest to the very heart of God. Of course, they're happy where they are, that's their DNA. That is why we cry. We laugh. We have sorrow. We have great celebrations. We have tears. We have tremendous laughter. The angels are limited in the area, but we have that. It is a wonderful thing that God made us to be like Him. But potentially, the greater the privilege, the greater the danger, correct? And that's what we all have been facing. But now that we are in the end times, we're coming to our glorious calling, we should rejoice in the greatness of our calling. And not live like before. Throw away the old mindset and understand, especially the revelation, Satan and all his cohorts will bow to Jesus in you. Let's all rise together. And He is Lord. He is Lord. Understand that we are the showbread, and all the privileges of what it means to be specially designed by God to be the bride of Christ, the glorious church, revealed to each one's heart. Though the understanding might just be beginning, let your light so shine and impart something greater than understanding, a knowing in each one. Oh, what a joy and privilege it is to be a part of our Lord Jesus Christ. Bless all the angels, the wonderful angels who have been caring for us like schoolmasters. And even now, taking care of us. Strengthen and bless them And they too desire to be blessed as we are blessed. Let that blessing flow through us to them, for it's also for them, but through us. Bless all the angels that have been faithful working with us. Establish your work, Lord, so that men and angels will sing how wonderful you are, O Creator of all creation. We bless you. Seal this knowledge in each heart. In Jesus' name. Amen. Give Jesus a good clap offering. God bless you. Amen.